me close and tell me how you feel. Tell me love is real. Words of love you whisper soft and true. Darling, I love you.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to this morning's service at Harefield. You've just been listening to Buddy Holly singing Words of Love. And Words of Love is my title of my talk this morning as we delve into 1 John chapter 3 in this series of Saved to Love. I'd like to read to you just the first verse of the chapter, which says this: "See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are." And when I read a chapter that I've got to study on today, I try and find a key. And as I worked through this idea of love, which the whole series is about, I came across 1 John 3:16. And it's just the first part of the verse which says, "This is how we know what love is." And when I read this, I just stopped. I just felt God say, "This is what you're talking about today. This is the subject." And of course, as I thought about words of love as per the song, and this is how we know what love is, I thought to myself, well, can I this morning explain what love is? Can I explain why I love one person more than I love another person? Can I explain what my love for my wife Louise is, or for my kids, in words? And I came to the conclusion I couldn't. So what I thought I'd do, I put together a list of the things I love. So I thought, I love Manchester United Football Club. I love my new car. It's automatic. We've changed one of our cars. It's automatic. The sat nav, you can... My kids, my grandkids, now we're talking. I love my kids. They make me laugh. They bring me a joy. The cat. I love the cat. And of course, I love Louise, my wife of over 45 years. I love Mr. Kipling's cakes. And I went on and on writing a list of the things I love. The problem was, when I went back and reviewed the list, I thought, I love Manchester United Football Club. I'm one of the 98.9% who support the club and yet have never been there. Never been to Old Trafford, never stood in the stands, never cheered. I love them. Not much of a committed love, is it? My car. Oh, it's great, the new car we bought, Louise and I. It's bright red, automatic, and I can go on about all its attributes and qualities. I love it. There's no reciprocation from the car. But of course, my kids. Now, that's getting there, isn't it? Because they're my own flesh and blood, and my grandkids. Yeah, that's what I can see, that I love them. Then I start to have a problem. The cat and the wife. I love them. But by saying I love the cat, and we all love our pets, I love the cat and I love Louise, there's no differential, is there? There's no, well, which one do you love more than the other, Barry? I love Mr. Kipling cakes. I've got a sweet tooth. I can't help it. And this word of love seems to fall flat in the English language. We have, 50,000 words, perhaps even 100,000 words. Winston Churchill used on a daily basis up to 25,000 words, they say. I can't comprehend that. And yet, we can talk about anything technical, describing this, the sunset, the trees, the flowers, creation. But when it comes to talking about the emotion of love, our language seems to be inadequate. Now, the French have had a stab at this. Je t'aime, I love you. When I say that to Louise, je t'aime, well, it's a very personal thing. And in French, je t'aime, I love you, or in fact, I you love, and the te apostrophe is tu, for you. I can also say, je vous aime, I love you. The difference is, I know we can say, tu is singular, vous is plural. But in essence, tu, or vous I should say, you say to anybody, everything. But tu is said to your personal family, intimate friends. It's a closeness. Now I know, I appreciate in French side today, these things have moved on and not quite as strict. But we were staying in the south of France with some friends one year. And I said to Liz, who they speak fluent French now, an English couple, explain to me tu and vous. And she explained the idea of family. She said, well, where we lived in the Dordogne, which I knew, is a village called Yayak, just nearby, she said. And an English woman retired there. And she got to know an old woman in the village. And they became good friends. They'd go around to each place for coffee, etc. And just talk and chat and just liked each other. And after a couple of years, about 2 years, the English woman thought, I think we've got to that place where I can call her tu. And so the next coffee morning they got together, she used the verb or the word tu in her sentence. Coffee finished. After that coffee break, the French woman never ever spoke to the English woman again because she'd crossed the line by saying tu. You can't just do it. When you come to the Greek language, they have many, many words for love. And here's just four I've picked upon because they're in the Bible. Storge, eros, philia, agape. Storge is that love and affection you have for your parents and your children and your family. And it's quite a passive love. You know, I love my brother. What does that mean? We're told to love each other. Eros, that more passionate, that sexual passion, that arousing of intimate love. Philia, loving those who are your peers, your friendships, your affectionate words towards people you hold in special esteem. Agape. And agape is a love which is an active word, loving in action. For example, in John 3:16, for God so loved the world, for God so agaped the world. He saw a need and he acted. He put his love into action. And that is what this word is talking about. And each of these four words I've picked upon, you can go into the Bible and find them. But I want to give an example where they're used. So if you come with me to John chapter 21, and this is the part of the Bible where Jesus has risen from the dead. Peter has denied Jesus three times before the crucifixion. I don't know the man, and he curses and swears and does the rest. And now the disciples have gone back to their homes and they're fishing. And Jesus waits on the shore and they see him. And Peter jumps out the boat and rushes the first to see Jesus. And as they sit there, Jesus says to Peter this. He says, when they'd finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Yes, Lord, he said. You know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my lambs. Again, Jesus said, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He answered, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said, take care of my sheep. The third time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, do you love me? He said, Lord, you know all things, you know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my sheep. Now we know that. He says it three times because he asked him three times because he denied him three times. Yes, that sounds good, but I don't think that's why he does it three times. Let me put it into the Greek context. Jesus says to Simon, do you love, do you agape me more than these? And he's referring to the fish. Do you love me more than these fish? An active love. Peter says, yes, Lord. Do you know that I love filio you? I love you like a brother, one of my family. Jesus says again, Simon, do you agape me? Yes, Lord, you know that I filio you. I love you as a brother. And the last time Jesus says, Simon, do you filio me? Grieved, he says, Lord, you know that I filio you. I love you like a brother. And Jesus was asking Peter if he loved him with the love of God, a love that might require sacrifice. He was asking Peter, are you going to love me that's going to put into action? Because I so loved the world that I gave my love. I agaped for the world. And if I was to continue that verse I read, this is how we know that what love is. It goes on to say, Jesus laid down his life for us. This is how we know what love is. Jesus laid down his life for us. And I find it fascinating, John's words. If you've got time, look at the John 3s. Go to his gospel and read John chapter 3, where we get the famous verse. But it's the man who's asking, how do I get to heaven? And Jesus says, repent. For God so agaped the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever loves him will not perish but have everlasting life. Agape. God acted. His love reached out. He says here in 1 John 3:16, Jesus laid down his life for us. That's a sign of love. Prepare to lay down your life. If you go to Revelation, written by John, 3 verse 20, it says, here I am, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me. We know it so well. But it's also saying, is if you don't open the door, you're not with me. There's a painting in St. Paul's Cathedral of Jesus knocking at the door. I think it was Holman that painted it. And when it was first displayed, it was put up for people to see. He decided to go and see the reaction. So he stood at the back of the crowd while people were reviewing this paper and admiring it. And this little lady called out, he's made a mistake. He's missed off the door handle. He can't get in. Holman did it deliberately. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice, opens the door, I will go in. How many of you have front doors? Anybody can just push the handle and go in. We have a handle on the outside of our front door. It doesn't do anything. Because you don't want people just barging in. And Jesus says, I knock, I knock. Only you can open the door and I will come in and you will be with me. And one writer looks at this study and says, if you compare it to Acts, it talks about standing in judgment. You will be with me. But if you don't open the door, you will not be with me. And it goes on to say in this 1 John 3, after saying Jesus laid down his life, we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. If anyone has material possessions and sees a brother or sister in need but has no pity on them, how can the love of God be in that person? Dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with truth and action, or actions and in truth. And he's saying here, it's not about the words, which is where we started. I can't explain love. It's your actions that demonstrate. When I got married, I said the vows in sickness and health. in riches and poverty, I'm marrying Louise. And what would it be if suddenly she got seriously ill and I just said, well, I'm not getting involved in that since I married you. That's not showing love in action. And same as James, you can't not say one thing and do something else. There's a contradiction. Love is about agape, which is active. It's not passive. I love my brother, I love my sister, I love my mum and dad, which it can often be. It's active. It demands action because love attacks all the emotional senses of a man and woman. And when I was been preparing this talk this morning, and I prepare any talk, if I'm doing a study, then I know I'm speaking to the congregation. But sometimes God will change that study into a preach. And invariably I'll say to God, if I'm preaching, Lord, who is it for? Because part of me says, Lord, I know it's for an individual. And more often than not, as I stand at the front preparing before the service starts, somebody walks in the door and God goes, that's the person that's for. And I go, okay, I know who I'm speaking to. And so often that person after service comes up to me and says, do you know what? That was just for me. And I go, I know. The same happened with this. I said, Lord, who is this for, this message? And he said, it's for you, Barry. It's for you. I don't know why you lot are listening, because this has challenged me in the light of what's been going on across the world. Black life matters. And the topic is a minefield. But I felt like I've hit a pause button. As a Christian, as a father, as a grandfather, as a church leader, where do I stand on Black Life Matters? And it has really troubled me the last few weeks. I've watched the demonstrations. I've watched some of the atrocities of some of the killings in the States, and a couple have really shocked me. I even discussed some months ago with my son about one of the deaths, who's a policeman. And I said, the man walked up with a knife and the policeman shot him. What would you do? Well, we're trained how to deal with those situations. We don't have a gun anyway, but we're trained what to do. We never do that. And it wrenched my heart. And suddenly I saw these demonstrations. I've seen the people on the telly angry and wanting a change. And I've been thinking, well, what's my response? I went to a church leader's prayer meeting of church leaders around the area. And one of the guys said, he just sat there, completely not the type of talk I'm used to him saying. He said, I don't know what to say in Black Lives Matter. I should be making a statement. What are you lot doing? And I said, I'm not sure I've got a platform to say anything. And it disturbed me as I sat there, and it's disturbed me ever since. And as I was preparing for this, I was on my laptop, and up came this quote. It's from a man called Andy Stanley. He's the head of the North Point Community Church in Atlanta, USA, a big church. And this profoundly affected me. The reason is, I'll just set the scene, I should have said, is that part of this, going through my own thoughts on it, I remembered a situation with my son, who's a police officer. And he'd been a special constable for about 5 years, volunteered as a police officer, all the rights of a police officer. And now he wanted to apply to be a full-time police officer. And you get a form, application form, like you do for any job. But this had about 30 or 40 very detailed question, scenario, or orientated questions. And you had three lines to fill in to explain. It was very, very difficult, and I helped him with it. But one question was about racism. And he said, I don't know how to answer this. I said, well, what about racism? And he said, but Dad, you brought us up not to be racist. I have no experience of this. And I've reflected on this with Louise this week. I said, we never talk to our children about racism when they grow up, but something in our manner told them not to be racist. I don't know how we did it, but in this Black Lives Matter, I realized that's not enough. And as I sat at home, this came up on my computer from Andy Stanley. He said this: it is not enough not to be a racist. It is not enough not to be a racist. Non-racist is not the goal. Being non-racist does nothing to address racism. Practically speaking, it amounts to indifference towards racism. If you're a Jesus follower, you must be, we must be, anti-racism. And that really hit me. It really hit me as a Christian, as a father, as a grandfather, as a Christian leader. It's not just not being a racist, it's being anti-racist. That indifference we can indirectly have. And I sat and prayed, and this is what I came up with. As a born-again Christian, I must stand up. I must speak out against injustice, against inequality, against lack of opportunity, against hopelessness, against segregation. It is my job as a Christian, as a representative of Jesus Christ, to speak out when the situation arises, whenever I can. Because agape love is action. It's not just my words, it is action. It is what we should do. I've listened to the anger and the despair. And I was reading an article in CNN newspaper on their website online. And the commentator wrote this article. He said, he was an old guy. He said, I've been to many, many black demonstrations about racism in the States. And they've petered out, sadly, he said. This one is different, he says, because white people have joined the black people on the demonstration saying the same thing. And I want to say, I'm anti-racist. It's injustice. It is wrong. It is not what my Lord would want. And it's about agape love. But that's not the only issue I struggle with. Loving people who are just difficult to love because of my thoughts and understanding. Some years ago, I came across a guy from another country, moved to this country, and he was had problems. Anyway, cutting a long story short, he got to a place where he was accused of raping a woman. A terrible crime. One of the worst this is. And he came and spoke with me about it, and I really was uncomfortable. Well, the woman went to the police and he was arrested, charged, and let out on bail. And bail means you are restricted in what you can do, restricted in movements, you have to report to the police on a regular basis. He chose to run away, to leave the area, which meant he was breaking the bail conditions. I don't know, a few weeks later or a month or something, he came back to Harlow and rang me. And I said to him, met him, I said, you need to hand yourself into the police. You need to give yourself up. And so he went in, handed himself in, and was immediately arrested and put into jail. And there was a court case, and he asked me, could I go? And I went to the courts. I think it was in London. I think we went to somewhere. And I spoke on his behalf that he had a Christian family done wrong. And so they gave him a small fine and they put him in prison until the actual court case was going to take place, decide whether he was guilty or not guilty, because they saw him as a risk of running away again. So he rang me from Chelmsford Jail and said, Barry, could you come and see me and bring some things with me for him? I'd never been to a prison, so I rang up the prison, went on the website, rang up to make an appointment. Yep, so come in, bring this, bring that. And so I go to the prison, you line up and they say, who are you? And you have to prove who you are. And then you go to, into the prison, started the prison buildings. And I'm in a big queue with lots of people, I'm assuming going to visit their family and friends. And there's police, prison officers all around looking. And in front of me was a young guy, late teens, perhaps early 20s, in sweatpants and sweatshirt, jogging gear. And I don't know what he did, but he got the attention of the policemen, the prison guards around him. Now, I have to say, it's a nerve-wracking experience because I felt like I was guilty in this queue. And they came over to this guy and said, right, empty your pockets out. So he puts his pocket inside out. Right, take off your top. So he takes off his top. Right, take off your jogging bottoms. He's standing there in a pair of red underpants. In front of, there's women there, men there. And they were, don't know what they were telling him off, because I was concerned because I was next in the line. And I wasn't sure what colour my underwear was at this point. You then get taken through to another room where you're the only person. And they say, sit down on this chair. So I sat down. Do not move. We're going to let a dog out. Do not make any sudden movements. And this big dog is led out of a cage and comes bounding over. And it sniffs you. It's a drugs dog. But the tension in me, he must have smelt the sweat and the fear. And then you go to another room where you're sat and monitored for half an hour with cameras looking at you before you get into the prison. It was the most nerve-wracking experience for me, because I was seeing a man who I didn't have a lot of neighbourly love for because of the crime he was being committed of. I went back, I think, another twice after that. But I thought I should do as a Christian, reach out. He gets moved to a main prison while this is going on. And I thought no more. About a couple of months later, I get a phone call from Barry. Any chance you could pick me up? I'm at Huntingdon Prison. I'm being let out. So I drove up north and into a village, and there was this prison. Picked him up. Never been to one of these before. And I said, what happened? He said, well, it went to court. The woman and the witnesses did not turn up. I've been completely acquitted. The man had got himself in a compromising situation, and the allegations seemed to be false. Agape love for me, I found very challenging and very difficult in that situation. And yet, how do I know what love is? Jesus laid down his life for me. How do I know what love is? My preparedness to lay down my life for another person. It says in 1 John 3, verses 19, the closing verses of this chapter, this is how we know that we belong to the truth, and how we set our hearts at rest in his presence. If our hearts condemn us, we know that God is greater than our hearts, and he knows everything. Dear friends, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have confidence before God and receive from him anything we ask, because we keep his commands and do what pleases him. And this is his command, to believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and to love one another as he commands us. The one who keeps God's commands lives in him, and he in them. And this is how we know that he lives in us. We know it by the Spirit he gave us. Saved to love. I can't explain the word love. I can't put it into words, but as John says, actions speak louder than words. How you act, how you speak also affects in a situation. What's your first instinctive thing to do? Walk away or walk towards? A picture paints a thousand words, said Telly Savalas in his famous talking song. Same here. Actions say a thousand words. I don't have the answer to Black Lives Matters. I don't have the solution I can just present to this situation that's unjust, unfair. But when it comes to me to speak out, I have an obligation. Not because I'm a church leader, because Jesus says, lay down your life. And I know when I get to the situations I speak out, it will offend those who don't like it. I'm laying down my life. Nothing compared to what Jesus did for me. But it's my job. It's my calling. And so, as I've prepared this talk and worked it through, it's not been a comfortable experience. But I know in my heart, I know in my conscience that I'm doing and saying the right thing. So let's close in prayer. Lord, I just pray your blessing on us now. I pray that you will just help us and guide us and speak into our lives, Father. I pray you will challenge us and encourage us what it means to truly love. You help us to understand what love is. Bless us in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless.